Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Round Ball Rules. We're here on the couch. I'm Robbie Thomson with Mark Milligan and Simon Hill. It's been a big week. Lots of news this week in the domestic game. We're going to be going through it all, siphoning through, separating the gold from the dirt and the bottom of the creek bed, because there's been plenty to talk about, starting probably with the bombshell that came, what we thought was the bombshell, Ante Milicic is leaving MacArthur. But that wasn't the bombshell. The bombshell was his press conference after the game that followed, where he just laid it all out on the table. And I don't know if he really explained all the reasons why he's leaving, just the fact that Ante Milicic has had enough. He's on the road. Now, this is a gentleman, Ante Milicic, a fantastic coach and great player for Australia as well, Socceroo, NSL winner with Sydney Olympic, fantastic striker. First gig in coaching, assistant coach to Jesper Olsen at Melbourne Heart, which was a startup club. Then he moved assistant coach to Tony Popovich, startup club.
I think it was John Van Sydney. Skip, wasn't it?
Johnny Van Skip first? Was he
not
assistant there?
Yeah, Jesper Olsen was okay. Part of the coaching team.
Stop.
Sorry to interrupt your monologue,
absolutely.
Robbie. Carry on.
And then got into the assistant coaching job with the Socceroos alongside Ange Postecoglou. Had the Olyroos for a little while, then stepped into the job with the Matildas, took them to the World Cup at the last minute. By all accounts, the players, the Matildas, enjoyed having him as their coach as well. And then the opportunity came to take MacArthur, another startup club, so after Melbourne Heart, after Western Sydney, this time as the main man. Millsy, start with you. How have you seen this career path? First of all, as a someone who's just starting out in coaching as well, it was linear, it was going up, and then suddenly it's hit what a self-imposed brick wall.
Yeah, well, I think you touched on a few important things there. You know, with three startup clubs, obviously one as the main man. I know I think it was 4 odd years he had with Ange in the national team. And, you know, knowing Ange and the way he works as well, I can imagine from Ante's point of view, that was no easy task in terms of demands that were put on him, workload, and just the general demands of national team. And look, I know probably one thing that was possibly tough for Ante was missing the Olympics with the Matildas, because, you know, as I believe, the plan was always sort of to go to the Olympics to step away and step back into men's football as a head coach. And obviously with COVID and all the fun that came with that.
The Olympics pushed back 12 months.
Yeah, so obviously those plans were then changed. And probably the biggest difference, even though he'd been at a startup club previously, was with MacArthur. He was then now starting a club up during COVID.
Yeah.
Very difficult to get Australian players home, let alone try and bring in foreign players. You know, when I came in, I know there was a few issues with players that had agreed but just simply couldn't get into the country for no footballing reason at all, you know, just with government regulations and things like that. So, you know, I think the demand over the last few years and the things that he had to deal with, you know, were very, very unique. And, you know, coaching, we know, is always a difficult prospect, and there's a lot of demands and pressures that are put on. I think you throw that 2 year period on top of that, and I guess to a sense I can see where he's coming from.
What was he like as a coach? Is he a good coach to work under?
Yeah, excellent to work under. Obviously, I had him as an assistant for a long time. To be totally honest, you know, a little bit
with the Socceroos.
With the Socceroos, yep. From my point of view, when COVID hit and I was over in the UK, I was done. I thought in my mind that was it. The only reason I continued to play was because it was Ante who called me, you know, and asked me to come back. So from that point of view, like I have a lot of respect for him, you know, both as when he was an assistant and as a head coach.
Well, last year, MacArthur just missed out on the grand finals, playing the semi final. This year, after 6 matches, they're sitting top of the league when COVID strikes again. And this is one point that Ante came back to. There was this 37-day period where MacArthur did not play, where the squad had COVID, where the league was knocked around, that late December, January period. And when they came back, it wasn't the same thing. And from then on, it was this struggle, just I mean, listening to him talk, it's like it was a struggle for him to get out of bed to come and coach the club. But this is the press conference. This is what he had to say at the end when it was all announced that he was leaving, and this was the post-match press conference.
I don't want to look at a laptop. I don't want to watch games. I don't want to take phone calls from players, coaches, agents. I want to watch teams that I enjoy watching as a fan. I want to watch good quality games at a nice time slot of the day if I do watch football. I want to cheer on Croatia in November in the World Cup and hopefully the Socceroos from distance. But I have no intention at all to look for another job or put my name out there or network or have any thoughts of coming back. And if I wanted to stay, I had a job here. If I wanted a coach, I could, but I can't give that commitment to the club and this group of players when there's nothing in me. I can't go on a holiday now and think that I'm coming back or I'm going to go work again. Otherwise, it's not a holiday. It's not a break for me. I can't have another assignment in me. I'm done. I'm on empty.
No point keeping that phone number in your telephone, gentlemen. If you've got it, he's going to change phones. There'll be no contacting Ante Milicic for the next few months. Look, on empty, got nothing more to give. Simon, that's after 2 years of coaching in the A-League. And I'm not saying it's Australian soccer that can do this to you, but this is a coach who we just talked about how his career path seemed to be setting up for this moment. This is the next step in what is a young coach going places. And here, it's just ground to a halt. I'm on empty. I have nothing more to give.
Yeah, well, look, you know, that may well be, in part, an indictment on, you know, football in Australia and the league, because obviously it's hard work. You know, you don't necessarily have the resources that big European clubs or clubs in South America have, so you have to do a lot of that stuff yourself. You're working with, you know, salary cap constraints. Obviously, COVID has had an impact, as you've rightly said. The interesting thing for me is, you know, this was actually rumoured at the start of last season that Ante would not even take the balls for this season. Now, obviously, that, you know, it's not played out that way. There were also rumours, you know, a couple of months ago that Mark Redan had already been lined up to succeed him next season. Obviously, that's not now happened. He's with the Western Sydney Wanderers. So I can't say I'm hugely surprised that he's decided to do this. Maybe a bit surprised that he's taken a complete break from the game. But I know that there are other things that have, you know, happened in his life. I think his father passed recently as well. You know, that can impact you. As much as we all love football and we're all hugely invested in it, it's not the only thing in life. Sometimes you do have to look after your own mental health and your family. He's obviously got a very close connection with Croatia. It's his heritage. I have no doubt that he owns a house or two over there. He'll have contacts over there. And when he's good and ready, he'll probably come back to work in football. It might not be in Australia. You know, I think as a sport, we have to look quite carefully at a lot of the previous generations, you know, particularly our golden generation. Mills is one of them, but he's here. But a lot aren't. A lot are living and working overseas. And, you know, maybe that's to an extent because the game here is very, very stressful to survive in. You know, it's living hand to mouth all the time. It's a struggle. We all know that. You know, we're the same in broadcasting. So maybe Ante's just got to the point where he's thought, look, I need a complete break from this, reset, recharge, and maybe in 6-12 months I'll think again. I understand it. I'm not saying it's great for MacArthur or for our league, because I think he's a promising coach. But you're right, you look at his demeanour and he's clearly had a gutful.
I'd like to change perhaps the focus of this debate now to MacArthur on the pitch. Millsy, when a coach announces, and I've seen this firsthand in the past, but when a coach announces that he's leaving, often that has a very negative effect on the playing squad and on the results. If we accept that perhaps this was announced internally at least, or that everyone knew, or apparently it was common knowledge around the club. We'd heard lots of rumours for months now. Like we said, that perhaps from the start of the season, he wasn't going to be there. Can that explain or can that have a negative effect on a playing group, on a squad of players who think, well, the coach isn't going to be here next year, or the coach by his own admission says, I'm on empty, I can't keep giving to the players, it's not fair to the players, to the club. Can that explain why the club has struggled the last 3 months?
Look, I've not exactly lived this scenario before. There's obviously been times in my career and people I know, their careers, where you sort of have a feeling that a coach might be moving on, whether that be, for his own reasons or getting sacked. And the dressing room does react to it. I mean, unfortunately, you probably both know as well, the dressing room can be a very fickle place. Like, it doesn't take much to disrupt a dressing room sometimes, especially when results aren't on your side. So, look, I think, yes, and probably the most important thing in that situation is that you have players in there that can control that. And with the club being so new as well, that can be difficult because you don't have people, just off the top of my head, like a Lee Broxham who's been there for 10 years and has the best interests of the club at heart. So he's able to sort of, nullify
bring
that to
together.
A certain degree.
Yeah.
So that was probably working against some, but look, to be honest, any sort of change or mention of change can affect a dressing room in both ways. So, look, it is a tough one. Whether it's directly related to the results, probably not. I think there's other circumstances that went to that, like you mentioned with COVID and the break, and obviously they've had injuries as well.
Yeah.
Then you sort of throw that on top of it. I think it was a little bit of a perfect storm over the last few months.
We did mention last week as well, when the initial news broke, was that this is also a pretty good A-League men's squad as well, and a side capable of, could have been largely capable with their playing personnel, at least at the start of the season, on paper, of getting. Let's have a look at the league ladder then, of where it stands and where Macarthur stand at the bottom, because they're not in the top half of the table, which is where they were for so much of the first period of the campaign anyway. Melbourne City, they're in action tonight against Perth. They can all but sew up the Premier's plate with a win. It looked as though it was Western United's to lose. Then it looked all of a sudden like Melbourne victory could be right in there. They dropped points as well. And now it's back in Melbourne City's hand. At the other end, Macarthur, with just one game left, they cannot catch Wellington in sixth place. They're 4 points behind them. Sydney are the only team who can catch Wellington, because last night the Mariners, of course, booked their place in the finals for the second year in a row. That's how that looks. This weekend, we've got the Big Blue. Sydney at home for their last ever game at Jubilee Stadium, taking on Melbourne Victory. A Victory side that, if things go their way, they could be pushing for that Premier's plate. A Sydney side that, depending on what happens tomorrow night, Wellington, they must win against Western Sydney to secure finals football for themselves. If they don't, Sydney will have a chance in the Big Blue to mix it up and throw their hat into the ring.
They've got to win both, haven't they, Sydney? And hope.
And Brisbane
it
next
could,
up.
It could be all done by the time they face Victory at the weekend. But all things being equal, if Wellington
do they deserve it, Simon? Do they deserve to qualify to win their last two and qualify?
As it stands, no, because they're outside the top six. Mm-hmm. They've had a very disappointing.
On something
campaign.
More emotive.
Do they deserve it? They'll deserve it if they
don't,
finish.
Don't give me logic and
well, it's
and
not
fact.
Done yet, is it? It's not done yet. So, look, there's no point going out on a limb and then being made to look stupid in a week's time. If they win their last two and Wellington slip out, yeah, of course they can make it. Yeah. And if they're there, then they deserve it. But as things stand, no, they don't. They've had a very disappointing campaign. And, we've talked quite a lot about Sydney, I think, over the last few weeks. Mm. It seems clear to me that the place needs a little bit of a revamp. The squad needs refreshing. I don't know, I'm sure you agree, Millsy. It's maybe in many ways a group, and I'm not talking about individuals specifically, because they've still got some very good players.
Yeah, yeah.
But
absolutely.
As a group, maybe it's just gone on a year too long.
Mm. Yeah, it does. I think it does definitely need refreshing. Obviously, you have the players that are getting a little bit older. I know exactly what that's like. you know, it takes a little bit longer to recover and things like that. And maybe the expectations you put on yourself are still the same as they were a few years before.
Just wait, Millisey, wait.
Yeah.
Just wait.
Wait till you get to
just
our age,
wait.
Mate.
Don't worry, I played on Sunday and I'm only feeling it now. So, but yeah, I think it does. I think the start of the year, I think we all expected Sydney to be up there and competing again because of the expectations that they've created for themselves. Hasn't been the
case. Four of the last five grand finals, three wins. Yeah. And this is a side that went from the top to potentially, looks like it, missing out on finals football.
Well, I'd also like to say, we've seen a couple of the younger players come through this season at Sydney. Patrick Yazbek in particular. Also, we have seen Callum Talbot, who I've been really impressed with. He's played left back, he's played right back. I'd like to see a few more of those, you know, younger players. I don't know what's happened to Callum Neuenhoff. I know he's had an injury. Yeah. I don't know if he's had COVID or he's lost form. I don't know what's happened with him. But there are others. I think Jaden Kucheski is the young guy who's knocked in 10 goals in the NPL season. And we're seeing it, you know, clubs like the Mariners, they're giving those youngsters opportunities.
Yeah.
Now, maybe, and again...
Was Yazbek by design or was Yazbek because Bratton was missing,
you know,
and they
had
to?
That's probably why he's had more of an opportunity. Mm. Callum Talbot, because Joel King left mid-season. It'd be good to see some of those next generation. Patrick Wood, we haven't seen a lot of. I'm a big fan of his. I think he's got potential.
Just one start in the A-League men's competition this season.
I think if the A-League shows...
Not the total answer, but I think that's maybe part of it.
Of course, but I think that this year the A-League's shown us, if anything, that yes, it's all well and good bringing these young ones through, but you need that balance of the more experienced one to be. You look at Central Coast, they have a good balance. You look at Adelaide. They have a good balance. Then you look at Perth, who have just had to throw in youngsters and have really struggled. So it is important when they're looking to go forward that, you know, yes, you have your Alex Wilkinson, so I'm sure...
Yeah, you don't throw them all out. Yeah.
No, of course, but they have to get that balance right next year. It can't just be a total overhaul. Mm.
Let's talk Big Blue, part of this equation as well. Millsy, you played on the other side of the Big Blue. What does this match
for both
represent? Yeah, true, going back.
Cheers.
So, well, which one did you prefer? No. But this match, you know, for victory to be coming up here with still plenty to play for, possibly second place, because that could make a very big difference in how the finals play out, whether you're second or third in the top two means you miss that first weekend of matches, you're into the semi-finals. Heading up to Sydney for a Big Blue, what does that represent for Melbourne Victory?
Yeah, it's a massive, massive game. It's always been a massive game. I think the very first game of the A-League was Sydney FC versus Melbourne Victory as a Sydney club.
First weekend.
In town at the SFS at the time. So there's been some fantastic games. I think there was the first 50-odd thousand at Etihad Stadium. We played in the start of the second season.
Yep.
Obviously, what I was involved in as well, the grand final at Amy, the Terry Antonis own goal.
That was the best grand final performance, by the way, I ever saw from a midfielder. He was a monster that day. You absolutely beasted Miloš Dimitrijević.
But yes, I did. But every time
that
this
was
game,
that was the whole game plan, was it?
It pretty much was. I actually said to my old man, I've been feeling terrible all week. And I said, oh, I think I'm going to have one today. I said, you know what? I'm just going to go out there. I'm going to kick everyone I can see. And it worked. So, but they always produce big games, big moments.
It's Sydney versus Melbourne. It's the two biggest clubs traditionally. It's the, you know,
and
it's everything.
Let me tell you, I reckon Victory will be hoping that Sydney are still in contention because they would love to deliver that fatal blow at the weekend.
Yeah. One of the stars for Victory has been Marco Rojas, particularly in recent weeks. The Alex Tobin points, well, first of all, he's been finding the back of the net. He scored a fantastic counter-attacking goal where he was on the end of just last weekend. In the derbies, the Kiwi, Messi, as we love to call him, he's been back to his best. Simon, how have you enjoyed Marco Rojas?
Look, he's a fabulous player, and he started the season off slowly because he'd had injuries.
Yeah.
So he took a while to get going. But once he finds his rhythm, he's still one of the best weapons that Victory have. Millsy, you played with Marco Rojas. How good is he when he's on the top of his game?
Yeah, he's unbelievable player. Very much in the early days with Ange, our system and the way we played was set up for him to put him into space. Obviously, you're still quite young, and you know, that helped him. But yeah, one-on-one situations, forward runs, the way he sees the game, midfielder's dream, because you know if you get into trouble, there'll be some sort of movement from Marco, you know, to get you out of strife. And I think, yes, he started this season quietly, but he was still threatening. He was still creating chances. He was still getting himself into goal-scoring chances. He just wasn't taking them. So I think he's built very nicely over this season.
I want to ask you a question about Marco Rojas, because obviously he went overseas. I think he played for Heerenveen and one or two other clubs in Europe.
He went to Germany first, and I think it was a little bit too high at that time for him anyway.
And it didn't quite sort of materialise for him. When you see Marco interviewed, and I've spoken to him a couple of times, he's this lovely, you know, Kiwi kid, very laid back, and yeah, everything's good, mate. Has he achieved everything he should have done in the game for you? Because he's such a talented player.
I thought when he went overseas we would never see him again because of what he was doing here, and then I guess you have to have a little bit of a look too at how he was used here and what we used him as well. You don't get that luxury over there. You don't get the luxury of having a slow start to the season and then continuing to be able to grow into that season. They just put the next one in. You know, so I think he's very much a confidence player as well. You go overseas, it's very difficult. You naturally need some time and you don't always get that. So I think it's been more, he's been a victim of, you know, circumstance and the way that the game is over there rather than the ability that he carries.
Yeah.
I think it's an interesting debate as well, and looking from the outside, from neutral observers, from former players, from people that watch the game, to say this idea that we should demand more of a player in their career. I think it's something, it's a hard one to answer, because you have players that for XYZ reasons made a decision, did what they did. I mean, Marco Rojas, he's a Kiwi international. He was Johnny Warren medalist when he was a kid.
Yeah,
fantastic career. And sometimes
better than mine.
But no. I'm not saying this about you. This is because you hear it all the time, and you hear it more and more now. Oh, but what a waste of talent. Yeah. That's his talent. He did or she did what they could do with it, what they wanted to do with it.
Fair point.
And it's not up to us to always demand more. And the big one is someone, and it's crazy to think it, but we hear it all the time, Ronaldinho. What a player he could have been, what a career he could have had. The guy won everything.
He won a World Cup.
But he partied too much. Well, he won the World Cup, he won the Champions League, I mean, Ballon d'Or. Yeah. But people still say, oh, but he could have, you know, could have kept going longer because he went off the rails and he went off. Oh, but that was Ronaldinho, that's what he needed.
But they're typical football debates, aren't they?
Exactly,
you know,
exactly.
No matter how great a player, you always think, yeah, but he didn't. You know, the big question mark against Leo Messi still is that he hasn't won a World Cup. I mean, goodness, imagine.
But he did win
Leo
the Copa
Messi.
America.
He did, but
that's our
Leo
next point.
Messi.
Who's better, Ronaldo or forget that.
Or Maradona.
Maradona. I'm itching for a chance to talk about this T-shirt, but we're going to keep moving.
Okay.
Next up, Simon, your game this weekend is a huge game, F3 Derby. Two big games for this final weekend of the season. And we've got to say, the Central Coast Mariners have done a fantastic job. They've basically thrown the gates open at Gosford and said, come on, get down there. There's free tickets for members and their mates, as many as you can bring down. Get down there. Newcastle, we hope that we saw plenty of Mariners fans at McDonald Jones 10 days ago. Let's see how many Newcastle supporters we can get down to Gosford and everyone else, because this is a game. We know it's a fierce rivalry on the Central Coast, mid-coast, but this is also a big game for the Central Coast Mariners. They've confirmed their place. They can still aim a little bit higher. Mm. And it's a great way to finish the season. It should be a party of football. Maybe golden boot race still up for grabs.
Ooh, yes, possibly. Mm. But, I mean, bigger than that would be a home final for the Mariners. They got that last year under Alan Stajic. Fell a bit flat against McCarthy. He played in that particular game.
Kicking people.
I think that, you know, the great thing about the Mariners, if you're in the finals, I don't think you'd want to face the Mariners, because I think they've got a real good puncher's chance in the finals because they can score goals. They've got Jason Cummings, they've got Marco Ranieri, who can't get a place in the starting 11 at the moment. They've got Moresh, they've got Garang Kuol, who I think is absolutely fantastic. I think we all do.
Yep.
So if you're in another team in the finals, you're looking at the other teams, you're thinking, Mariners?
Yeah, no,
you wouldn't particularly fancy that, would you?
No, I don't think anyone would. It's a tough assignment. Mm. Like you said, the biggest thing for them at the moment is they have goals. They have goals in the starting 11, they have goals off the bench, and they have goals from different areas around the pitch. So I think they are, yeah, this derby leading into finals, the last one was absolutely fantastic. Mm. I think this one will be no different, coming off Newcastle's last result as well. They'll want to finish with a bang. But, yeah, I don't think Central Coast will be an easy assignment for anyone come finals.
How good, not Messi Ronaldo, how good is Garang Kuol? 4 goals in 90 minutes off the bench. This is a 17-year-old who has just exploded onto the scene, and not even this season, this month.
Yeah, he is super. He, like his brother, he has that work ethic and, you know, that run to him. But I think his final touch, his final decision, his final pass, his final shot is much better.
Yeah.
I think he's a more complete player. I think as a defender, he'd be a nightmare. He comes inside, he goes outside. You see in his finishing, it's not just raw power. It's an understanding. He looks to have an understanding of the game. And that's, I think, his greatest strength.
It's technique as well, isn't it? I mean, you look at 2 of those goals that he scored there were scored on the half volley, which, you know, takes exquisite timing, particularly to get past the goalkeeper into the corner of the goal. So I think he's got big potential. Obviously, it's early, and you don't want to go over the top with a young kid. And Alu Kuol is, you know, finding out at the moment just how tough it can be in Europe as well. But he's certainly got something a bit special. He's one of those players. There's not many, but when they come along, Nathan Burns, I remember back in the day, you know, you go, oh, this kid's got something. Daniel Arzani was another. I saw it a bit with Rami Nazarene, but briefly, it's not quite happened for him as yet. Alu Kuol, particularly last season. Nestor Iheanacho, I think, is another one who's, you know, makes you go, wow, hang on a minute, this kid might have something. And Garang Kuol is up there.
Just very quickly, I know we're running over time and we have to go to a break, but with a big blue, with an F3 derby, with finals football coming up, I wanted to have a very quick discussion about pressure, because I think, particularly looking at the F3 derby, when you see how the Central Coast Mariners have finished this campaign, when they were really struggling, I mean, halfway through the season, they were not in contention for finals football, even though they had games in hand, they had, you don't win anything with kids, etc., etc. They were going to struggle.
Thanks, Alan Hansen.
Exactly. But Monty, has managed to turn this around. And when you look at what Newcastle had just 3 weeks ago, when they had a chance still to make the finals, and I noted down 3 goals they conceded in the opening 20 minutes against Western Sydney in the game they had to win. This was the game we had to win. Then the very last chance, the last slither of an opportunity, 3 goals in 30 minutes they conceded against the Central Coast Mariners. And both times they managed to come back. And this is not directed at Arthur Pappas, but it's a learning curve and something about using pressure, and because pressure can paralyze you. And that's what it did in those 2 games of Newcastle, in games that they had to win. And pressure can also be a liberating force, and you know this from playing in World Cups and with the national team. You have to use that pressure, because without the pressure, you can't perform at your best probably as well, but it can destroy you like it's destroyed this. And I'll come to you, Simon, first, but obviously for Millsy, who's played in it. What do you feel about pressure, and what have you seen this season in sides that, and it's every season and it's in every game, expectation to performance, and what is so impressive about a side that's number one and the target that everyone's trying to knock off is that they can answer that pressure and draw on that pressure and makes them stronger.
Yeah, well, exactly. You can't allow it to become paralysing, because I think when you talk about Newcastle, for instance, you can obviously see that the pressure before the start of the game has got them to a point where they come out and they're very tense, and I guess it becomes an expectation they're putting on each other, that they get to a point where they know they can play, we just have to go out and execute, then that expectation becomes a little bit much. And then you see their quality because they come back into the game.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's just being able to release that pressure and know how to use it before you go in. I think maybe the good thing with the Mariners is there are so many young players there, maybe a little bit naive to pressure.
Yeah.
They don't allow that to then become a part of their game in terms of what the performance looks like. You know, yes, there's that external pressure there, but it sort of gets pushed aside because it's not being put on them from the club, or maybe because halfway through the season they weren't expected to do anything anyway. Mm-hmm. So maybe as a young one you feel sort of anything you get now is a little bit of a bonus. And I think that, like you said, that pressure very much depends on the leaders in the change room, what that pressure becomes. Whether it becomes something that you can use to help motivate and bring an intensity into the game, or whether that pressure becomes too much and it stifles you as a team. Yeah. So I think that just comes down to the dressing room and the players that you have in there and the experiences that they've had before under pressure.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think also it depends very much on how the coach deals with the psychology of his players as well. He knows them better than anybody. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he can relieve that pressure in some ways by loosening things up. Or I'll give you, you know, one example. Many years ago, I covered the Western Sydney Wanderers Central Coast Mariners Grand Final 2013. And I was asked to go in and do pre-game interviews in the two dressing rooms. And I went into the Western Sydney Wanderers dressing room, and the Western Sydney Wanderers dressing room was deathly quiet. Everything was very much businesslike. And this is, you know, that's how Tony Popovich coaches. I'm not saying it doesn't work all the time, because obviously it does for him. But it felt quite stifling in that dressing room. I went along the corridor, and the Mariners dressing room, even before I got in there, the boom box was going, Danny McBreen was acting up, people were throwing things. It was like they were having a party. And I think that was Graham Arnold's way in that particular moment of knowing that his team had been there before, of course, against Brisbane 2 years ago and lost. That's a very big psychological burden for them to have to try and deal with.
Yeah.
So you wanted to relax things. So coaches can make a difference. One more point on this.
Well, that's also the coach allowing the players to do their thing as well, to know how to do it themselves.
One more example. I mean, the greatest example of pressure at the moment, I think, in world football is in the Premier League, Man City and Liverpool, neck and neck for the title. And because of the way that the TV games are organised, one team is normally playing before the other. That's pressure. We saw it at the weekend. Liverpool had a very tough assignment, and they knew if they slipped up, there could be a problem. They grounded 1-0 out against Newcastle, probably using that, to be honest. And then that puts the onus back on Man City, who are then under huge pressure to go and win at Leeds, and they won as well. That's how you deal with pressure, isn't it? You just got to have good players, I reckon.
Yeah, exactly, and players with experience that know how to thrive on it. Another example I was going to use was Wellington as well.
I thought you were going to bring in Bordeaux.
Finally getting back, getting home. No, that was the coaching chat, right. Bordeaux. I could talk about pressure and PSG, but I'll just start crying and crying and crying. So we won't go there. Yes, Wellington's first home game of the year when the Mariners got one over them as well, when they would have been so looking forward to performing on that stage at home in Wellington as well. They didn't get the result they wanted.
Well, that's true.
And that's, you know, and even though they had chances, obviously, in that game. Anyway, we are going to go to that break. Don't forget, Saturday night, 7:45 on Network 10, the F3 Derby or the Big Blue as well. Two huge matches that are going to definitely go a long way to deciding what happens in the finals. And particularly, I'll be on the mic for the Big Blue. Here it is.
But then it's sung past from Rojas for Thalami! As Sydney bring out all the artillery, and it's Bobo! And there it is! The chance for Ninkovic!
Welcome back. You are watching Round Ball Rules on 10 Play, the home of Australian football, with Simon Hill, Mark Milligan, myself, Robbie Thomson. Chat now is going to focus on the Asian Champions League. Disappointing campaign. We've spoken about it in the past. We're going to wrap it up now. We're not going to spend hours talking and just piling on the two A-League men's teams that have bowed out of this competition. But it was very disappointing. There's no denying it. It was a disappointing campaign.
Get all your caveats away early, Robbie.
Sydney FC, gentlemen, I commentated their last game. It didn't matter if they won or lost against HAGL Hoang An Gia Lai, the Vietnamese club playing at home. Sydney FC lost a fourth game in a row. It was Brandao, their Brazilian, in difficult conditions, as you can see this time, to the heat and the humidity. We added a pitch that was more or less unplayable in certain areas as well. But HAGL, you'd have to say in the end, once again for Sydney FC, deserved winners, HAGL. There's the goal from Brandao 5 minutes before half-time. Gentlemen, something, and normally when I commentate a match, I don't try and analyse it. There's normally an Andy Harper or a Mark Milligan or a Daniel McBreen alongside to do the analysis. But this was just a side that couldn't take that next step up. They needed to find answers. They needed to respond. And it just didn't happen. How can we explain this? And it's not just the sixth game in, you know, it could have been two there in the last moments, but this is not just the sixth game at the end of 2 weeks, which of course is grueling and takes it out of everyone. But this is a perennial campaign that comes back again and again and is going to have serious ramifications for Australian football moving forward, starting next year.
Well, look, you know, we can point the finger at individual clubs or individual players. The bottom line is we've had one club qualify for the round of 16 since 2016. That was Melbourne Victory, who were promptly then knocked out in the round of 16. We are where we're at the moment. Mm. We are not amongst the elite level of nations in Asia. That's not a nice thing to say, but it's reality. You look at the round of 16, there are three clubs from Saudi Arabia, there are three from Qatar, there are three from Japan, there are two from South Korea, there are two from Southeast Asia, and we've got none. And that's been a regular story over the last 5 or 6 years. It unfortunately, you know, says where our league is at and where our teams are at. We have to try and correct it. It's funny that the conversation around where our game is at really only happens when the national teams start to struggle. But the evidence is there year in, year out in the Champions League that we're not up to snuff at the moment. How you change it, I don't know. You know, I think certainly the removal of the salary cap, and I know people are against that here, they're very wedded to the idea of a socialist concept of a league where everybody has a fair chance of winning. Well, unfortunately, that's not football. We're a global game. And if that means some of the bigger clubs getting bigger, so be it. The world is full of big clubs and small clubs. I think we've got to, you know, take the brakes off. I know Robbie Cornthwaite has said this on the A-League podcast. We've got to take the brakes off our bigger clubs and those that can afford to maybe go out and get some better players or spend more to keep their better players here, then they need to be allowed to do that. I don't think that's the total solution. I do also think before you go to Mills, I'm not going to go on too long, but and this again is a much bigger conversation, but I think the lack of meaningful games for large swathes of the season in the A-League is starting to have an effect as well. I don't think there's enough pressure on players throughout the entire campaign. That comes, of course, with a second division promotion relegation, and we know all the arguments for and against. It's a long way off yet. But, you know, we're seeing it this time of the season now where the games really mean something if you're going to be in the finals or not. How much better the intensity of the matches is, that it means something. And qualification for Asia should mean something as well. That's going to become, you know, more in focus now that our coefficient is so poor that we're actually losing spots in the Champions League.
The 20th ranked club
next
league
year we'll have two teams in the AFC Cup and only one in the Champions League.
Yeah.
And that might not be a bad thing because I think it's a wake-up call as to where we're at. We've got a lot of structural reform that needs to happen in this game. The Champions League, and we can look at individual mistakes and games, but that is the barometer of the health of your domestic competition. And at the moment, our domestic competition is not healthy enough.
Millsy, Sydney FC finished bottom of that section. They drew their first two games. They lost the next four in a row. There are the standings in Group H. It doesn't make for pretty reading. And as Simon just said, for the last 3 years, Australia has had the A-League has had one side, the champions, or the side, the Premier's place winners, qualifying automatically for the Champions League, plus the cup winner and second place going into the playoffs, four Champions League spots. We saw Melbourne Victory lose to Vissel Kobe this season in a thrilling match, and we also had Sydney qualified via that game against Malaysian club Kayo FC. So they qualified for the Champions League to join Melbourne City, but Sydney have won one game, one Asian Champions League game in their last 18. And so when we say the A-League men is stronger, we should be able to beat BG Patam for the other group that we'll get to in a second, or we should be able to beat HAGL Vietnam side. The proof is there, and the proof is relentless. Every year it's the same. We shouldn't be thinking we should just beat these sides. Why do we think we can, and how do you explain the fact that we just can't?
Yeah, I'm not sure why we think we can, because, like you said, it is directly linked with the national team and the struggles that we have through Asia. It's no different for the domestic competition. For as long as I can remember us being in Asia, I can remember teams complaining about having to be in Asia. But it's not going away. It's what we are.
It's what we wanted.
And now we're dropping even further down the pecking order. So it's going to be worth, I guess, even less to clubs. So until we acknowledge that we as a game here need to start improving, because then the Champions League will start improving, and then that is related directly to the national team improving, then we're just going to continue to slide.
How can you possibly think that, oh God, we've got to go and play in Asia as well? You just want to keep playing Central Coast, Adelaide, Wellington.
There's no arguing. It's extremely hard. But
when you're a footballer, that's what you want.
It's also a lack of cultural. You know, we pay lip service to Asia in this country. Let's be brutally honest about it. You know, we tend to view Asia in a football sense as what we can get out of it rather than, you know, what we're actually experiencing or what we can contribute. So, you know, and I'm as guilty as anybody else. I sat in that chair, you know, a few weeks ago and said, if Melbourne City don't win that group, then they shouldn't be in the Champions League. Let's move to that and have a look at the standings
because yes, you said this is the easiest group that an Australian side
paper,
has ever had in the Champions
on
League.
On paper it was, and I tell you that the wake-up call for me in particular was watching the games against the Jeonnam Dragons, who are in the Korean second division. They're not even top of the Korean second division, they're mid-table in the second division in Korea. And I'd say Melbourne City were fortunate in both those games. Jeonnam dominated those two matches. Now, okay, the conditions were tough for Melbourne City. They had a couple of injuries. They're unlucky not to go through in terms of, you know, the way the qualification system has worked out. But really, that should be a wake-up call that a mid-table second division Korean team can dominate with the ball largely against Melbourne City, who are, you know, the best team, or have been the best team in Australia over the last 12 months. You know, that speaks volumes.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
Rather than using that as, you know, saying that that's the level that we're at the moment, I still think we turn and say, oh yeah, but the, you know, there's this excuse for what we did, where I think this is a direct indication of the level of our game at the moment.
Mm. Yeah. Absolutely.
And the national team reflects that, as you say.
Correct.
Because these
men's and women's,
these leagues are getting stronger and stronger. Yeah. We saw in the Asian Cup for the women as well. I will say that I think Melbourne City are a little bit unlucky to go through, because basically, just to explain very quickly, we had five groups of four teams. The three best second place sides would go through. One group though, Shanghai Port, couldn't travel. Kitchi were in that group. They didn't have to play Shanghai Port two times. They didn't have the extra games in that group. And basically, the results in the other four groups, the results against the bottom side were discarded. So Melbourne City's chance was to try and finish top. No matter how many points they had in second almost, the 6 points they picked up from beating the bottom side fell away, so that they could only have the same number of points as Kitchi, who snuck through. It's complicated. I don't know if you understood anything that I just said.
No idea.
We got the abacus out.
Basically, they were unlucky. I think they were unlucky not to go through.
They were, but even so, as I say, I think, you know, that group on paper. Yeah, BG Putnam United, and they're at home, of course, as well. Their own conditions, they were going to be tough. But I think, you know, really Melbourne City should have gone through. And it's unfortunate.
They shouldn't have needed to be unlucky.
No.
Okay, let's move on. That's the end of the Champions League chat. We have a lot of football coming up during the finals and after exhibition matches coming this summer. It all kicks off Barcelona versus the A-League All-Stars on Wednesday, the 25th of May, which is going to be a huge week for football in this country. The 11th of June, Brazil versus Argentina. Do we know what the final say on that is? Is it a friendly or is it that infamous World Cup qualifier that was...
I thought it was the World Cup qualifier.
It was meant to be, but Argentina don't want to play a World Cup qualifier. And ethically, I think it's a bit tough if you start playing your World Cup qualifiers wherever you want just to earn a bit of coin or to, you know, to go on show. These exhibition matches, though, we just saw as well a swathe of English Premier League clubs are coming out. There's going to be hubs in Brisbane, in Perth, Sydney, Melbourne. It's going to be great for fans of the likes of Crystal Palace, Manchester United, Leeds United, Aston Villa are coming out as well for the Mark Bosnich tribute match. I assume how that one was couched. What do we make of this, gentlemen? I'm looking forward to it. I have no qualms with sides coming out, and it's been, I think, if you look back in history, we've always had touring sides come from the 1950s. Sides would travel around South America for players trying to make a little bit of money playing as many matches as they could all the way through. Now it's clubs needing to make money. That's why they're here. There's no doubt about that. Simon,
look,
my only caveat,
I have no problem with it. These clubs coming out here as well, you know, it's a business and they're trying to make money, and obviously there's money in it for Australian state governments and the venues as well. My only caveat is I want there to be something left behind for the local competition. Now, I'm told that Stanley Townsend, the APL, are looking at, you know, mining all the data from all the football fans that go and watch these games, who might not necessarily turn up to watch the A-League on a regular basis. If that's so, good. Because we need something out of this as well. They can't just, you know, arrive, play, take the money and leave. Because that's taking money out of the game here. And we need, as we all know in this country, we need money to be put into the game. So, you know, so long as we're getting something out of it for our local competition here, because that's the most important thing.
Millsy, Barcelona versus the A-League All-Stars 4 days before the grand final. What do you make of the timing? And what do you think about the concept of having a Barcelona come out and play an All-Star side?
Yeah, look, I think the concept is fine. Obviously, it's been done before as well. You know, maybe the timing, a little bit strange for me.
They're talking a festival of football, aren't they? Sort of the build-up to the...
Yeah, they're trying to build up a week of hype, I think. Yeah. Like to say, put football on the map, get it in the press, get it on the news. This week, football's coming, and ride the coattails of that All-Stars game into the grand final.
Yeah, which is fine. But then you talk about, well, it's not really an A-League All-Stars team as such, because you got two teams who won't have anyone available.
Yeah, and that game's going to be in Sydney in the grand final. More than likely, it's probably going to be in Melbourne, isn't it? So
exactly. Yeah. So look, I think the concept is fine. I think going forward, maybe we can work it a little bit better if we get the opportunity again in terms of timing and being able to utilise the people that are coming. Maybe build the hype off the back of a grand final, watching potentially some of the best players from the grand final, then back up against one of the best teams in the world is another selling point in itself. But yeah, look, you can't complain. World-class football coming to our country. You know, as a kid, they're things you remember. I remember watching the Ollie Roos play. I remember watching Parramatta Power play and Northern Spirit, and I remember when foreign teams came. So it's, look, like you said, though, as long as something's coming back to the game here, that's most important.
No, we've got to keep filling the coffers and filling the spirit of the local game as well. That's it for us. Before we let you go, don't forget we have a big match coming up on 10 Play Paramount Plus, live and exclusive on Paramount Plus. The FA Cup final in a couple of weeks' time, Chelsea versus Liverpool. Before that, plenty of A-League men's action as well, which we'll all be looking forward to as well, starting tonight. I think there's a big game on in Perth as well, so tune in for that on Paramount Plus. And from me, Robbie Thomson, Simon Hill, Mark Milligan.
You called me Mike.
I didn't call you Mike. That's it for us. We'll see you again next week for more Round Ball Rules.